Hello everyone, a very good evening to you all. Welcome to the third edition of Quantum Mutual Fund's E-Paths to Profit. I am Gaza Jain and I will be moderating today's session. Overdue for some time now and eagerly awaited, the fiscal stimulus by the Indian government is finally here. How many of these measures announced will improve liquidity? How many will replace incomes? Will this stimulus package equivalent to 10% of GDP help the Indian economy to get back on its feet? Or are these measures too little, too late? We will be discussing all this and more today, but a couple of instructions before we begin. All attendees have been muted so that the session can function smoothly. Audio of the speakers and myself only has been enabled. If you do have questions for the speakers, please send them to us using the chat option on the lower half of your screen, and we will try to take as many questions as we can at the end of the session. Without further ado, let's get started with our first speaker, Mr. I.V. Subramaniam, CEO and CIO, Quantum Advisors, and board member, Quantum AMC. Subbu will take us through the major announcements of the stimulus package and the impact they're expected to have on key economic variables. Over to you, Subbu.
Thank you, Ghazal. Welcome everyone to this E-Path to Profit. I think we just met a week back. I'm glad that I'm able to interact with you again. The only difference between last week and this, so last week we were expecting an economic package to be announced, while right now we have the economic package spread over 3-4 days with a lot of information. So let's look at what the government has done, and then from there we will go on to what are the implications for the different sectors or for the economy. We will cover all of that. Go on to the next slide. So just to give a background, as you know, the economy was anyway slowing down. So the lockdown, which was announced on 25th March, it continues to be there right now. They have opened up in some regions, in some cities, but overall the lockdown continues. And as we had calculated and showed you last time, a 60-day lockdown would mean a GDP loss of around $240 billion. Bear in mind that Indian economy is around $2.7 trillion. So $240 billion out of that is roughly in the region of less than 10%. The unemployment rate has spiked, as was expected, given the low economic activity. And CMI just reported saying that it has spiked to 24%. And they gave the number of employees has reduced from 404 million to, I think, roughly in the range of around 200 odd million. There are still a lot of interstate migrants and the exodus of migrants from one city to the back to the rural India will definitely have an impact on normalizing the production. Most of the companies don't have cash to really, wait it out over the next 6 months. If the lockdown continues, business does not improve, there will be a serious problem for some of the small-sized, mid-sized companies and even some of the larger companies which are high on leverage and less on cash. The only bright spot appears to be that agriculture is reasonably in good situation. Rural economy, therefore, by and large should be okay. We haven't yet seen any major spread of the virus in rural India, and nor have we seen any indications of activities slowing down significantly over there. The action plan from the government, what was expected, and it was very clear from the goals perspective, if one has to look, the government had really three or four broad areas. One is to transfer the cash or transfer money to the bottom of the pyramid. A lot of people who lost their jobs, who lost their business, daily wage earners, vendors, etc. You needed to replace their cash to support them. Then, of course, the industry needed some support so that to minimize the job losses. Some amount of liquidity measures to ensure that companies which are leveraged continue to at least have access to money and interest rates do not spike. And certain government fiscal monetary policies which would stimulate demand and maybe even a government spend in certain areas. Go to the next slide. So what have they announced? If you look at the segment breakdown, so we are writing over here that the government's action clearly seems to be misdirected. In the sense, we would have expected, and we did expect, that large amount of money transfer would have happened so that people who have lost their livelihood, people who have lost their daily wage, would be replenished, and therefore they will be able to sustain their lives and maybe consume to a little extent. So the announcement, while the number looks large at 21 trillion, if you break it down, a significant portion of that is actually liquidity driven, which includes the liquidity which was provided by RBI and the liquidity being provided now by other institutions, so either to agriculture or to MSME. The major portion of the 21 trillion is actually just announcing that there is liquidity available. People who want to borrow can have access to that, subject to certain conditions. The one which is marked in red, the poor and the migrants, the amount of money flowing to them is actually very, very low. And that is where the real pain point is right now. And we would have normally thought that a larger proportion of this amount would have gone to the migrants and the poor, who have left urban India and have gone back to rural India. And even those who are staying within urban India, how do you take care of them? That kind of cash transfer would have helped, and that has not happened. Asset creation, NREGA-related spending also continues to be very, very low. On the right-hand side, if you look at the sources of the stimulus, again, it's largely RBI and other institutions like NABARD, etc., and some from the government. So majorly the 21 trillion which has been announced, it is more of liquidity, making available money, as opposed to direct transfer. And that has limited role to play at this point in time, when actually a cash transfer is what was needed. Go on to the next slide. So the GDP, which was slowing down, which was drifting the whole of last year, is likely to continue in the same range. It's unlikely to spike in the immediate future. And therefore, the V-shaped recovery, which quite a few of us expected, or some of the economists also expected, given this stimulus, that V-shaped recovery may not happen. It's going to be a long-drawn recovery which would take place. So the drift will continue. Next slide. So here are some of the key announcements. I'm sure you must have read in the newspapers, but if you look at rural poor, migrants, then the free food, the gas and the LPG, the concessional credit given through Kisan credit cards, agri-infrastructure fund, MSME for the medium and small enterprises, some sort of collateral loan. These are some of the major announcements, and they are all mostly liquidity driven. To look at this slide again, NBFC, house finance companies, interest subvention on real estate of a certain category of real estate if you buy. TDS has not been, TDS for non-individuals to some extent has been deferred. It can put some cash into some people's hand, but it has to be paid. So it's not pure cash. You are only delaying the payment of the TDS to a later date. So all of these measures, when you look at sector specific, it is again very liquidity driven. It's again like lending. It is again like giving loans, as opposed to direct transfer of cash to certain segment of the people. While these are important, but at this point in time, these don't really drive the economy. These will not really push the economy back to recovery at a faster pace. It will help a few companies. It will help a few medium and small enterprises, but it will not drive demand in general. Go to the next slide. If you compare it with other countries, like I don't have the data for some of the emerging markets we didn't get, but if you look at some of the larger companies, developed market, and you look at the direct cash transfers, clearly the amount which is earmarked in India is quite low compared to what has been announced in UK, US, Canada. And this has not, I don't think this has got anything to do with the wealth of that nation, because these are budgeted amounts which can be adjusted, recovered over a period of time. You just needed to take that step. And I think India did not do that. And that cash transfer is substantially lower compared to other countries. Next slide. If you look at the actual cash transfer to individuals, it works out to broadly around $7 in India, which is based on the 500 rupee per month to women Jandan accounts, and then certain amount to the Kisans. This is of course far lower than some of the other countries. Again, some are per month basis, some are one-time payments. If you look at US and Canada, they are one-time payment, but Australia and UK, they are on a per month basis. Even assuming that the wage costs are different, the kind of workers are different, it's a developed country, but still $7 appears to be quite low, because that may not be enough for the people to start consuming and start to feel comfortable. Support to small businesses, if you look at the last column, again, each country has done it differently, but some of the countries have done some very good thing is to ensure that people are not fired from their companies, and therefore the wage subsidy is given by the government so that the businessman doesn't feel, you know, under pressure to remove employees because some of his wage bill is reimbursed. We have not seen that kind of benefit in India. So that's again a big difference. So cash transfer is very low, and the collaterals being given in the form of wage subsidies is not there in India compared to other countries. Next slide. So again, if you look at the table, it tells you where the money has gone, transfers in kind, liquidity for firms. And there I gave you a split of the stimulus package, but if you have to base it on percentage of GDP, the economic package is roughly around 10.4% of GDP, and a substantial portion of that, nearly 80% of that, is just boosting liquidity. Very little impact on fiscal deficit, and that means that spur which we required. A stimulus means actually a spur, a push, which was required in the economy, that is not likely to take place from this package. Next. The same amount, if you look at it from the other way, from the demand point of view, from a capex cycle point of view, it will have a negligible impact. Because the demand required a stimulus in the form of cash transfer for people to start to consume a little, not splurge, but at least consume a little, that kind of demand stimulus was not there. And even on the capex cycle, given the slowdown, the private capex is unlikely to happen immediately. So, and from the government side, again, there has been no announcement on any large capex push. Corporate earnings, therefore, still looks optimistic based on Bloomberg consensus estimates, and most likely it will be revised downwards. I think many analysts were also waiting for the stimulus package to estimate what will happen to the demand. But now that the package has been announced, it's likely that they will reduce the EPS estimates for next year. Next slide. We are, as we have shared with you last week and earlier also, we are bottom-up stock pickers, but we have certain macro assumptions. Our long-term estimates are what is given over here. But near-term for FY21, we had taken a 0.2% growth in GDP. But that assumed that migrants would come back after 60 days and normalcy would resume by probably in the last quarter of this year. But now with this kind of stimulus, it doesn't look like that will happen. So most likely that 0.2% will be revised even further downwards. It could be negative. When I talk to our macro analysts, it looks like it could be anything between -2% to -4%. And from there, that base, we need to see a growth next year. So clearly this year, there will be a lot of pressure on GDP and earnings. The next few quarters will probably show that. The other broad assumptions are what is given over there in terms of inflation, 10-year bond and FX rates. And these are the things we use when we evaluate and judge and value companies. So this is a very broad view on what we thought the stimulus package was supposed to do and what it did. Nilesh and Saurabh will take you through some of the estimates on EPS, the impact on certain sectors, and those kind of stuff. And then we'll be happy to answer any questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Subbu. Your presentation makes it clear that the 21 trillion rupee economic package is expected to have negligible impact on GDP. Even though there are a spate of liquidity measures, there are hardly any cash transfers or income infusion measures to provide the much needed demand thrust that is needed in an economy which is expected to contract by 4% this year. So what kind of impact will this disappointing stimulus package have on equity markets? Will it spur economic growth? Will it impress investors? This will be answered by our next speaker, Mr. Nilesh Shetty, Associate Fund Manager, Equity. Over to you, Nilesh.
Yeah, hi. Thank you, Ghazal. Thank you, Subbu. So again, I'll just take over, take you over what the sort of environment was. Subbu has already laid out the GDP environment and the macro environment. While equity markets for a long time were a different orbit. Now, just to go back in history, April or FY 14 and 15 were drought years for India, and rural demand was very weak, and we were under a distress situation. So earnings in general were very weak. But after Mr. Modi came into power, there was this massive rally in equities, devoid of earnings. And the sell side kept on assuming that things will normalize in the future. 2016, there was a bumper harvest. We had good monsoons after a long time. And somewhere around the festive seasons, it looked like earnings were about to pick up. And when we spoke to corporates then in 2016, around Diwali, most of them were saying consumer demand was very strong and they're seeing strong revival. But just after that, Mr. Modi launched the demonetization, which essentially killed the recovery instantly. And post then, it's been a real struggle. Now, after that, we had a series of other setbacks, including demonetization, ILNFS. But unfortunately, the market just kept on rallying. So every year, the sell side would start with very high estimates. And by the end of the year, there would either be flat earnings or very little growth. So if you take the earnings growth from, say, calendar year 14 to calendar year 19, the cumulative earnings growth has just been about 10%, despite a strong market rally. So market has just been driven by price and flows and not necessarily by corporate activity. And in that environment now, this year again, it looked like there could be some strong revival in the offing. We had a great monsoon. Rural India was about to have a bumper harvest, and it looked like there was some sort of revival on the anvil, and then we got struck by COVID. Now, this year, FY20 anyway has ended on a weak note, and earnings estimates just in the month of April has been cut really sharply. Even though they still expect some growth, we will be very surprised if earnings cut are not cut further, and they slip down and get back to probably 2014 levels. So essentially, there will be 4-5 years of zero growth in corporate India. And essentially, markets are reflecting that lack of earnings. So our sense is earnings for next year, FY21, as well as FY22, will be cut sharply. And you will have very weak earnings growth over the next 2 years. Next slide, please. So again, last few years, it has just been PE expansion which has driven markets. Since earnings were not rising and you had relentless flows, price to earnings just kept on rising for most companies. That has seen a sharp correction. So now we have closely in, or we've corrected to our long-term average valuations. So valuations offer some comfort, even though earnings might be under stress for the next 2 years. Next slide, please. Yeah, and over the last 2 years, this one of the big changes that have happened in the Indian markets has been the comeback of the retail investor. Now, if you take the 10 years before 2014 or even longer, allocation to equities was a net outflow. So retail investors were gradually moving away from equities. But post 2014, once Mr. Modi came into power, allocation to equities just took off. And there were multiple reasons for that. One is, of course, crude collapsed quite dramatically and interest rates in general came down in India. Second was real estate market, which was anyway inflated, started seeing price correction, and a lot of people got scared to allocate to equities. And in that environment, you saw this early stages of a rally in equities, which sort of triggered this reallocation in people's investment basket. And suddenly you saw a spike in allocation to equities. So now, as per RBI, traditionally allocation used to be about 1-2% to equities, which is now spiked to close to 10%. Whether that is sustainable, we'll have to wait and see. Now, most of that money has come in the last 3 years, so very close to market tops. And our sense is either people are sitting on no profit or most of them are sitting on losses. In that environment, if they continue to see losses, you might see outflows again from equities. Fortunately, the SIP number still continues to remain strong, and that is not moved despite the correction. But if you see the net flows number, month on month, it is halved. So in the month of March, we were close to 12,000 crore net inflows into equities. In April, that has fallen to just over 6,000 crores. And most of that is strong redemptions from equities. So if the markets continue to slide, we might see more outflows from equities and reduction in flows. There is a long-term story where Indian retail investors are not have a very low allocation to equities, and we expect that number to sort of increase over a long period of time. But near term, you might have some pull out from equities if the markets continue to slide. Next slide, please. Yeah, and foreign investors have always loved India. In times of stress, they tend to pull out, but by and large, they tend to have very large allocation to India. So this year, particularly in the month of March, there has been a large withdrawal of close to $8 billion. But so far, retail flows have countered that. We still have a net inflow from local retail activity. We expect that number, or at least net flow, to continue, but the number could be lower than what we've seen over the last 3 years. Yeah, so that's sort of the end of my slide. I'll hand over to Ghazal now, and who will sort of hand over to Saurabh, who will take give you a sectoral overview on the market.
Thank you, Nilesh. Our takeaway from your presentation is that yes, even though earnings growth estimates are expected to be cut sharply over the next couple of years, valuations too have corrected thanks to the pandemic-induced nationwide lockdown. Now, it remains to be seen if strong domestic flows will hold up and for how long, considering that the stimulus package has failed to instill confidence or reduce fear among investors, which may trigger them to reallocate and shift their assets out of equities. Thank you, Nilesh, again. Now, let's dive deeper. Our next speaker, Mr. Saurabh Gupta, Associate Fund Manager Equity, will help us decode the impact of the stimulus on the various sectors of the Indian economy. Over to you, Saurabh.
Thank you, Ghazal. We heard Nilesh and Subbu talk about how the stimulus is not helping the companies and even the individuals, and the markets don't look attractive. There are a lot of macro headwinds that we are facing. So Quantum's equity team has been interacting with a lot of managements and a lot of business experts, industry experts, to have an understanding of different sectors and how they are positioned in this tough environment. So we thought we'll take you through different sectors and their outlook, or give you some sense on how different sectors are expected to behave. To start with, on slide number 20, starting with consumer discretionary, clearly the impact would be negative, as we are hearing a lot of news about people losing their employment, businesses getting shut down, and salary cuts happening. And discretionary spend is a spend where people spend where they feel comfortable in spending, in the sense that when you feel that your incomes could go up, you could upgrade your refrigerator, you could upgrade your television, or you buy a new car. So that spend will definitely take a hit, as people, as of now, everyone or every individual and every business is focusing on preserving cash and liquidity. So clearly the feedback that we have got from the ground is that consumer discretionary will take a hit in the near term. There could be some rural companies, rural-focused companies, which could benefit because the Rabi season has been good, and this whole COVID problem looks like it is more of a rural problem as of urban problem as of now. So they could fare a bit better, but overall things appear to be a bit weak for the consumer discretionary companies. Coming to consumer staples, by staples we mean anything that you consume despite having tough times, in the sense that all the FMCG companies or food companies come in this category. So demand destruction could be a little less. Weakness in demand would be less than consumer discretionary, where people will have to consume to have a living, but definitely they will downtrade. So downtrade means that if, say, example, you are buying Dove as a soap and your income levels are weak, then you might move to a Lifebuoy or a lower end soap, just to give you an example. So that is downtrading. So over 4 or 5 years, last 4 or 5 years, or maybe a decade, a lot of companies have benefited because of premiumization, where people move from lower end products to upper end products in India as prosperity increased. With that reversing, there could be pressure on margins for these companies, because lower end products give lesser margins to companies. So that could be a headwind for consumer staples. On energy, definitely the demand is weak because airplanes are not flying, trains are not running, we are not taking our cars and two-wheelers out. So demand is extremely weak on the transportation side. With this ease of lockdown, things seems to be improving, but it's still below the pre-COVID levels. The fall in crude prices will not benefit because of government's unsatiable need for funds. They have not passed on any benefit of falling crude prices either to the oil marketing companies or to individual consumers. So that will not help. But lower prices will definitely negatively impact the oil producers because their realizations will fall. Coming to financials, the current stimulus has given some liquidity measures, but our sense is that NPL accretions will happen because individual households and businesses' ability to service their debt has definitely reduced considerably because of this lockdown and this whole problem. So there will be a spike in non-performing assets once this three-month moratorium which the RBI has given gets over. Then the picture will be clear, but definitely NPLs would be higher. Now, pre-COVID also, things were not that great for this sector because corporate NPAs were rising. But after COVID, we believe that SME and individuals or retail credit will also run into trouble. So that's clearly a negative of financials. On the healthcare side, there is no impact. So pre-COVID, they were growing like mid-single digits. But post-COVID, what has happened is that other sectors are declining, wherein this will hold on to that 5-6% kind of growth. So there's a lot of sector fancy in this sector which has happened. Fundamentally, nothing has changed in this sector. It's status quo. Coming to slide number 21, we'll talk about industrials. So by industrials, we mean companies which help other companies build factories, build large plants, boilers, turbines, and other things. So the capacity utilization has been low. So demand has been weakening for some time in India, and most companies have deferred their capital expenditure. And with COVID coming in, with corporates also preserving their liquidity and demand not picking up, and the stimulus does not help in picking up demand, clearly the industrials will also suffer. There will be no private capex that we believe can happen. Clearly there is a weakness in real estate and infra. So their sales will also suffer. But a positive or a silver lining here is that the commodity costs have declined, and fuel costs and energy costs have declined, which are large part of the cost of these companies. So the profitability impact could be less than what is happening at the revenue level. So that could cushion some impact for these companies. Real estate was in tough times before COVID. They managed to survive through lending from some wholesale NBFCs. Now those NBFCs are struggling themselves to raise capital. So clearly, weak developers will default, and we expect that there should be a price correction in real estate. Technology demand is expected to be weak here again. It's one of the few global sectors that we can invest into, and they are not related to India-specific problems as such. But globally also, businesses are getting weak because COVID-19 is a global problem. But if we go back in history of 15-20 years, these companies have handled these slowdowns pretty well. Their balance sheets are pretty strong. So we are not unnecessarily worried about this sector. There could be some near-term demand pressure points that could build up, but we believe the company managements are well equipped to handle that. The good part is that they have managed their supply side very well. So their service deliveries have not got impacted despite this very, very stringent lockdown, because more than 90% of their workforce is now working from home. So that kind of agility that they bring to the table, I think they can manage this cycle pretty well. Utilities or companies who produce electricity, distribute electricity or gas, we believe that these companies are not impacted because they are regulated return businesses. They make fixed amount of profitability as guaranteed by the government. But in the stimulus, the government to help the power DISCOMs or power distributor of different states have told the central utilities to share some of their rebates and profitability with these companies. So that could have an impact in FY21 profitability for these companies. Telecom appears to be a winner. Not many companies left to invest in this sector, but clearly work from home and extra usage of data, their ARPUs could increase and should benefit, largely unaffected and marginally positive as far as sector is concerned. So moving to the slide number 22, what we think about our current portfolio and our portfolio positioning. Clearly, when this all scenario was building up, what we did was our portfolio positioning historically also has been a lot focusing on the quality of companies and quality of balance sheet. So we did the stress test of all the portfolio companies, and most of the companies have very strong balance sheets and liquidity so that they can survive the tough times or loss of revenues despite having full costs. So that stress test we did. Some of the companies have a little bit of debt, but they have very strong parentages. They can infuse capital anytime when they require. So we are not unnecessarily worried about those companies as well. So we believe most of our portfolio companies, in fact, all of our portfolio companies, to survive this down cycle. And because weaker companies which have wrong balance sheet structures in terms of debt and leverage will go out of business, these companies which have good balance sheets and have great market shares could actually end up benefiting. So our portfolio positioning is clearly towards that. We believe the existing portfolio stocks should emerge stronger. In March, when the markets fell because of this COVID problem, we managed to get through very good names in the portfolio, which we were willing to buy at a price that we wanted to, and they finally came to that price after a long wait. So our portfolio is now stronger with greater quality companies and stronger companies which are market leaders in their respective categories. Overall, we believe there will be a tough 12 to 18 months for the macro, for the country, and for equity markets. But as a long-term investor, this is a great time, as Nilesh highlighted in his presentation, that valuations after a long time have become really attractive. So we will definitely, this justifies an increased allocation towards equity for equity investors who have plus 5 years of horizon in their mind. Within equity allocations, as we have always said, that you should diversify your style risk. In the previous EPTP, which was conducted by Ajit and Subbu, we highlighted that our value strategy has not done that well because value has been out of favor for some time, for extended period of time. So our advice to our investors always has been to create a bouquet of different styles and different caps. You can do so by, so our preferred allocation for our investors would be 20% to Quantum Long-Term Equity Value Fund. That is your anchor investment. And maybe Quantum India ESG Fund, which is the new fund launched by Quantum AMC, both managed by Quantum. And 80% to Quantum Equity Fund of Funds, which is a basket curated by Chirag and his team of different fund managers, different AMCs who have good products in different styles and different caps. And he has curated that portfolio of good funds. So with these two subscriptions, you can have their... you can have your equity allocations ready for the next 3 to 5 years, though next 12 months definitely could be a little tough. Yeah.
Thank you, Saurav.
Yeah, so Ghazal, just a moment, I'll just complete this slide. This is a basic of how different management styles work. Clearly, you see that Quantum Equity Fund of Funds has outperformed Quantum Long-Term Equity Value Fund. And if you had a combination of 80-20 strategy, which we had recommended, you could have performed, your portfolio could have performed better than a larger allocation QLTEVF. So that's our thought process. While this will depend upon your risk appetite and your liking, a lot of people love value investing. They could have a higher exposure to value investing, but there will be periods of pain in different styles. So it's up to an individual about what kind of basket of equity products you want to create. Yeah, I think that's all from my side. Ghazal, you.
Thanks, sir.
Over to you.
Thanks. So the near-term impact on most sectors is likely to be negative, but despite pain for about 12 to 18 months, current valuations do justify an increased allocation to equity, could provide solid returns over the next 3 years. And by diversifying across different styles of management through the 80-20 approach, where you invest 80% in the Quantum Equity Fund of Fund and 20% in the Quantum Long-Term Equity Value Fund, investors can optimize their returns. So thank you, Saurav, again. It's time now to take some questions. The first question is for Subbu. Many question this stimulus package as mere optics and less substance. What's your view, and what are the areas where the relief measures have a positive impact on the economy?
Yeah, so it may or may not be optics, but clearly the goals for which it was set out, in the sense, why did we need a stimulus? What does a stimulus do? It was supposed to stimulate the economy. It was supposed to spur some action as the lockdown closes. So that goal does not appear to have been met. Although the number is large and as a percentage of GDP, it looks big. But a large section of that, large portion of that, as we had seen in our presentation, is purely providing loans and liquidity and credit guarantees. So if you are already having loans, or if your business is slowing down, will you be inclined to take more loans? Possibly yes, to meet certain working capital needs in the immediate future. But sometimes it's unlikely that you will go and borrow more, because you know that probably that business is going to be dull over the next few months. So from a spurring economic activity spurring point of view, I don't think this package has done anything much. It has largely provided liquidity through variety of means, and certain reforms have been made in this in the area of agriculture, but they are mostly beneficial in the long run. What we needed right now was a cash transfer, which will help the migrants to probably stay back, or even to help them make a decent livelihood, even if they are heading back to rural India. And that has clearly not taken place. So you can look at variety of example. If a migrant in Bombay was earning around 10,000 rupees now, and if he now heads back to UP, UP government will probably give him, based on whatever they have announced, 1,000 rupees per month. So clearly a 90% drop is in income. So he won't be able to give money to his family. And therefore the whole chain will have an impact in terms of consumption patterns, etc. So that should have been addressed. Since that is not addressed, the recovery in the economy will probably take a longer time, unless the government comes up with something else in the next few weeks.
Thank you, Subbu. The next question is for you, Nilesh. What is better for the next 2 years? Stay put in equity or switch to fixed income?
Yeah, my advice is always have a sort of asset allocation plan. I mean, you cannot sort of, objective is to have a long-term asset allocation plan and then just stick to it. Right now, because valuations are a lot more reasonable, most stocks are 40-50% lower to where they were in January. Allocation to equity does make sense, and people who have not allocated to equity, perhaps now is a much better time for you to allocate to equities. But long-term, just stick to your long-term asset allocation plans. Having allocated to equities, you must realize that next 12 months could be stressful. Think of equity markets as more of a convenience. In times like these, you go back to your basics. And as Ben Graham said, if you're living in your house, if every second you get a price ticker, you will not take it seriously. So think of equity markets as a convenience. If equity markets go berserk and give you an exorbitant price for your holdings, you exit. And if equity markets, like they're in an environment right now, go berserk and on the downside, and same companies who were 4 months ago valued at a certain price, now today are valued at 40-50% lower, it does make sense to allocate, with the caveat that they might go lower. So just sticking to your long-term asset allocation plans and allocating based on that, and taking advantage of opportunities like this, where you might just want to increase it slightly, makes for much better long-term investing.
Thank you, Nilesh. Saurabh, the next question is for you. Which industries or sectors will be leading in the next bull market?
So I hope I'm audible now. So
yeah, you're clear.
So over the last 10 years, and we create that buckets, so we don't focus on sectoral allocations, but we have seen these buckets that there could be periods where 2 years a certain sector does well, and for 3 years again it does not do well. So we always prefer people to have a diversified equity basket based upon certain anchors like valuations and good quality companies, and don't focus on too much on sectors, and don't be disproportionately higher to one or two sectors. Ideally, anchor yourself to valuations, and based upon that you can decide what sectors you want to buy into. If a certain sector as of now valuations look attractive, you can add to that. But having a sector allocation for next bull market, we believe it's not a great idea. Ideally, anybody should have a diversified equity plan, either through mutual funds or direct if he can himself select stocks.
Okay. Thank you, Saurabh. Next question is for you, Nilesh. In your opinion, is the Nifty going to go down below 7,500?
Yeah, unfortunately, I wish I knew. I don't know. I think there are enough risks to take it lower. The stimulus has been a washout. I think corporate India has now to fend for itself. Even consumer demand doesn't look like next 12 months will recover. So there are enough reasons it could risk lower, but nobody knows for sure. So I don't know whether it can go down to 7,500 levels or 8,000 levels, but there is risk to the current market levels. It could go down. What we think is over the next 3 years, still equity markets will generate decent returns even from current levels. There is in the intermittent period, it might go down and bounce back up again. But there is a case for allocating equities right now without trying to time the bottom and just wait for the next 3 years for equity markets to generate returns.
Thank you, Nilesh. Subbu, the next question is for you. What will be the impact of increasing tension between China and United States on the market?
See, any tensions between global players does rattle all kind of markets. Now, specifically, what this will do, we cannot say. But if the tensions increase, it will have a risk aversion impact. And people will move out of riskier assets and have safer assets like, say, gold and those kind of stuff is where they will invest. At this point, probably it's too early to say that this will play out into a bigger issue, but there is always that risk. And one needs to be aware that whenever these kind of risky event happens, that equity markets will take it.
Thanks, Subbu. The next question is for you, Saurabh. What will happen to the banking sector and large banks if the lockdown is further extended? Are our fixed deposits in these banks at stake if the stimulus doesn't work?
Look, so for deposits in scheduled banks, we believe it is safe. What our sense is that government will not allow any scheduled bank to fail because it will result in a systemic crisis. That is first part. Secondly, government has enhanced the security, the insurance part. So your deposits up to 5 lakh rupees is secured. And these larger banks in India by far are well capitalized, they are well managed, and we believe that we should not be fear in terms of going concern for these banks. They are very well capitalized and well managed, as I told earlier. Only thing is that yes, NPLs would be higher because we can clearly see that the ability to repay for anyone has been compromised, both corporates, SMEs and now even retail. So they will have higher NPS, but they have been providing for it. And the balance sheet strength of larger banks is there to handle this situation. So you should not be worried about their going concern. But yes, NPLs should be higher for next maybe 6 months or a year or more.
Thanks, Arv. The next question is for you, Nilesh. What are your views on the Hindu rate of growth? Are we moving towards that?
Yeah, I mean, after the 91 reforms, it was not believed that India will go back to Hindu rate of growth. I mean, there are mistakes that the government has done over the last few years, which has dragged down overall economic GDP growth. It looks like over the next few years, we'll certainly be growing lower than what we've done, say, from early 90s till almost till 2007-8. Whether we go back to, again, 2-3% is highly unlikely. Perhaps we might settle somewhere in between. Our fixed income team is still working on it. But our sense is perhaps it'll be a lot higher than the Hindu rate of growth, but lower than what we've seen over the last, before 2014. Maybe somewhere in between is the answer.
Nilesh, Saurabh, any of you can take this. How to keep faith in the idea of long-term appreciation of equities when the value of one's equity portfolio can fluctuate widely? How to time the withdrawals?
Yeah, Nilesh, you want to take it?
I mean, equities, like, again, going back to what I said earlier, you have to think of equity markets as more of a convenience. You have your long-term asset allocation plans, and if for whatever reason markets, which swing wildly on emotions, if they go berserk and give you a price for your holdings, which are unreasonable, and that is the time you take advantage of that on either way, either on the upside or on the downside. But apart from that, you stick to your long-term allocations. Withdrawals are linked to more goals being achieved. So if you're trying to save for a house or for your child's education and you have a target corpus in mind and you've reached that target corpus, assuming you had 10 years you kept for it and you reach it in 5 years, there is no reason to risk that money. Once you've achieved your goal, just take that money out and put it in a safe asset class. And as long as you've not achieved your goal, you can continue to allocate over based on your long-term asset allocation plans. So, I mean, looking at equity portfolio valuation day-to-day is not advised. You do a periodic check once every quarter, once every 6 months, and look at what your valuations are telling you. But by and large, do not get swayed by a day-to-day market movements and get upset by share price going up and down. Equity markets or the stock exchanges are essentially a convenience. But by and large, just focus on your long-term allocation plans and your long-term goals that you want to reach and allocate based on that.
Thanks, Nilesh. Saurabh, the next question is for you. What are your views on privatization of key sectors?
So privatization, definitely the way last 1-2 years the government has been selling stakes through CPSE ETFs slowly at discounts, it had destroyed value both for the government and for equity holders in these companies. So that was definitely not a great idea. We know that privatization will help because PSUs generally are not efficient, to be understood correctly, at the levels of private companies. So privatization should help, but then it should be along with the sector reforms that are supposed to happen. So, for example, if you are trying to privatize an oil marketing company, then the pricing of the petrol or the diesel cannot be with the government. It has to be the be based upon the demand and supply and prices of the crude. So it works hand on hand. Only privatization won't help. But definitely privatization is a much better idea rather than slowly selling the stock through CPSE ETFs, which destroys value both for the government and for the investors.
Thanks, Nilesh. The next question is for Subbu. Is the Made in India theme of the government only a washout?
See, we had this over the past many years, even when the Modi won the elections in 2014. At that time also, we had this Made in India efforts being done, right? And now also, again, there is a talk about bringing the business from China, etc., so that encourage factories to be set up here. It is the washout in some sense, because unless you have the whole environment ready for it, nobody will be willing to move. And when I say environment, it requires everything, right from labor policies, land policies, how do you ensure that the corruption is less when a large company tries to set up things over here, skill sets, the vendor chains. It's not when one company announces, it's not just that company which comes in, strategic thinking which takes place. And if you have to attract these kind of companies, you have to ensure that not only the main company, but everyone around them also are able to do the business easily. So in India, that is not the case. The second thing is, even if you get them to do business, they would look at some great infrastructure in terms of, you know, how are they able to export, how easily are they able to export, what kind of imports they can do, how quickly they can get the imported goods into their factories. So there are a lot of logistics issues which they will also plan out. So I think we have serious bottleneck in some of those issues. So when we are trying to say that, you know, make in India, come and make in India, unless we set up this infrastructure, better ports, better roads, better quick turnarounds and skill sets being improved, it's unlikely that we will see a large amount of companies coming in. Yes, some companies will come. Some company will try to diversify their manufacturing base and therefore they will come to India. But if we have to attract many people, then we have to bring about these changes. Then we will see a lot of action. Otherwise, probably the action will be a lot less.
Thank you, Subbu. Since we're running out of time, the last question is for you, which I was going to ask you before you got disconnected. Can you share your views on gold and currency in the current market? I request you to answer this and then give the closing remarks.
Sure. On gold, as we have always at all paths to profits, I've also said that you need to have around 10 to 15% of your wealth in gold. So don't look at year-on-year returns. Look at long-term trends. Look at the fact that it's a great instrument to hold against any risk, particularly against risk of paper currencies. Then gold is a great asset class to own. Chirag, our colleague, has written so many articles around gold. You can go through that on our website and you will get a good understanding as to why gold is important. So our suggestion, even though gold prices have gone up, even at this point in time, you need to have 10 to 15% of your wealth in gold. the when risk in the world increases, even at that time, gold is a great asset to own. So right now, things look risky. So therefore, there is a trend towards buying of gold, and people are increasingly buying, not only individuals, but even governments are trying to buy gold. And that's what we read and hear, and Chirag has been sharing it with us. So my point is, have 10 to 15% of your wealth in gold. Don't change that that asset mix. Whatever you do in equities and debt, have some exposure to gold. On currencies, clearly we were expecting it around 80, which is very close to where it is right now. A lot will depend on foreigners' confidence in India. At this point in time, we have seen an equity outflow in the month of March. But if that confidence is not there in Indian fiscal deficits, in Indian reforms, then despite the large amount of reserves which we have, you may see the currency depreciate very, very fast. So it all depends on how we manage our situation. If, let us say, this migrant issue becomes into a major social issue tomorrow, and we are not able to manage that very well, then you can see a currency slip. Right. So many factors go into that. Right now it's at 80, but if we don't manage some of these issues, then even holding a large reserves may not help, and the currency may slip very, very rapidly.
Thank you, Subbu. Nilesh, any closing remarks for investors of the Quantum Long-Term Equity Value Fund?
Yeah, I mean, especially for investors of Quantum Long-Term Equity Value Fund, I think last 3 years have been in tough for them, especially given the environment that we've laid out. Trying to find value in a market which was frothy and not backed by fundamentals was tough for us. This correction has offered us a lot of opportunity to buy quality names at reasonable valuations. We are doing some reallocation on the sectoral weights. And we are confident of the portfolio that we've built. Most of the companies that we have right now are essentially very strong on the balance sheet side. Great managements. We are fairly certain that they will be able to survive the downturn and thrive once things normalize. So hopefully next 3 years will be a lot different than what investors have seen over the last 3 years. And we'll get back to our long-term outperformance in the markets.
Thank you, Nilesh. Thank you to all the speakers for their time and insights. Thank you, everyone, for attending. We hope you found this session to be informative and useful. We will be back with more such sessions soon, so stay tuned. Wrapping up the session now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ghazal.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.